for having a remarkable memory. And I'd like to start off by telling you how famous I am for having this infallible memory of mine. I'll approach it with 2 points, which I think when you hear it, you'll realize that I'm telling you the absolute truth. One is, I've never forgotten my name. Second, I forgot the camera for tonight. That's why we're using this instrument. So let me invite you, as a consequence of Lazarus allowing me to come here and talk, and I thank him for that. This is the title, The Way of the Logos. Our culture is not passive to philosophy. Once we realize that, change is possible. So long as we do not realize that, we are in a quandary, a curious quandary. We don't know why no one has any interest in anything meaningful and doubt it, and doubt seriously that there can ever be any meaning. Now watch, our culture, by design and by education, teaches Stoic philosophy. Second, as a consequence, they also teach Pythagorean philosophy. Every teacher in the state of California comes to learn how to deal with difficulties in their classroom, and they're taught the same principles regardless of what college or university they go to. They are taught that whenever there's a conflict in a classroom, when there ever is a conflict between the student and the teacher, you look at them and you say, hasn't everyone a right to their own opinion? And who's to say who's right or wrong? For everyone has a right to their own opinion. And therefore, sit down. And the child quickly gleans from that, oh, if everyone has a right to their own opinion, and every opinion varies from person to person, therefore there's a relativity that denies there is any meaning. That's our culture. That's what's taught. This talk, I'm introducing The Way of the Logos. There's something curious about this idea. It is not part of our culture. This is Hellenic. It's not Christian logos. It's Hellenic. I would like to take you through this in order to show you that there is actually a spiritual path using the mind, through the mind, and therefore, how is that brought about? It's brought about essentially by the most curious of all phenomena. We have the problems we have for a good reason. And there's a better reason to understand how to get out of the problems that we have. Problems are a gift. A problem is the ceiling of your own mental view. It's where your own logos is blocked. You're blocked for a very good reason. We'll go through it and explore it with you. The solution to such blocks is the advance into the logos. What are these blocks there for? You know what they are? They're pathologos, sick beliefs. Sick belief. A sick belief is a belief that is false about the nature of the self and the nature of reality. So long as it is entertained and accepted as true, it shapes your vision of yourself and reality, and you're caught within the confines of it. The most important thing is not that. The most important thing is we have to discover why is it we believe the kinds of things we believe. Unless we understand why we are brought to believe the things we believe, there's no way out. In every case, wherever you discover why you believe what you believe, you'll find out that's a very good reason you came to believe it, even though it was false. That's where we're going. So therefore, with reluctance, I'll take this first sheet off, though I have a certain fondness for it. I am not often met with such applause for my first conference. The timing was very good, and Brad told me he was going to arrange it, and he's sitting back there. Look at what is the problem? Okay, what's the problem? Two words are important. The idea of necessary and divine. Two words, curious, right? The problems you have to have. They're necessary. They're the ceiling of your own development. It's the spiritual level you've reached, and you're caught, and you can't break out. So look here. I am now going to talk now as a philosophical midwife. You see, Socrates started this game. He called himself a midwife. He said, you know, I'm just like my mother. He said, my mother can spot a woman at the earliest stages of pregnancy. She can help them through all of the difficulties and the travails of childbirth. She can attend the childbirth. She can even help the delivery. And furthermore, he says, there's a secret I don't like admitting. He said, but my mother is also good at deciding who would make the best partners for one another. And therefore, he says, I'm reluctant to mention that function since it goes by the name of the pimp. He says, I'm exactly the same, except there's one difference. He said, I can spot people who have problems. They go through parallel processes in every way. He says, you can take every stage in midwifery that a woman goes through, and you can match it analogically with a man who's having difficulty, or a woman who's having difficulty with a problem. Well, then how shall we proceed? In this game, we start with a cornerstone of midwifery and the cornerstone of Platonic philosophy. Let me add one thing quickly about Platonic philosophy. There is no such thing. There's no. It's a confusion in terms. Platonic philosophy is actually a rational way to proceed with the mind, to understand the mind, and to understand one another. By putting the word Plato on it, it sounds like that's just another view. No, no, it's not another view. It's a cornerstone for a tradition that explores the mind by using the mind, with the assumption that it's through the mind you can know the mind, and by freeing the mind, you therefore enter into a more profound state of mind. So how do you start? In Plato, one of the great dialogues which I entertain everybody to get into is Plato's Meno. Right? What's so important about that? Plato's Meno advances one notion that's central to philosophy and to my philosophical midwifery. Here it is. If a person gets to the point where they have to admit, on the most fundamental level, I do not know. Look here, this person has a problem. They've tried everything they can think of to get over it. They try all of the advice that's been given them. They're still blocked. They don't know what to do. If they can say, therefore, in truth, that I don't know what's going on, I am stuck. That state of being stuck is called being stung. Therefore, in this game, if someone comes to someone like myself and says, hey, I want to talk about the nature of my problem, they have to prove to you that they have the problem. They have to say, I'm stuck, I don't know what to do. Second step. You then ask them, what evidence do you have that you have a problem? They have to furnish in their everyday world, how it's manifested. What does that mean? That means they have to tell you they're struggling for something. See, they're struggling for something. And in their struggles means there are stages they have to go through. To reach, it has has to be now, not a practical goal. Those are minor. You want to see whether you can get the person to admit that they have a personal, meaningful goal. Personally significant. And they've gone so far that now they're stuck. And they can't go any further. So you say, excuse me, that's a very nice claim. Can you please tell us when you experienced that state? What time, where, when, how? That's manifest. Say, well, it's very interesting that you have that difficulty. Is it possible that you can reflect and see that you had a similar problem in the past? This invites them to say, wait a minute. Is it possible there may have been something similar that I've experienced in the past? But wait a minute, what is the problem? They have to go to the next step and say three things. Most important. They have to say, not only am I stuck, but I'm in a mood, a state of mind, sometimes called feeling state. They have to be able, therefore, to talk about the feeling state they're in, which I call the state of mind. Obviously, they have to talk about the situation. And most importantly, any ideas or words that go along with it, any ideas, thoughts, images at that time that they face when they're in this quandary. Given that, then they can say, wait a minute, I think I've experienced this before. And therefore, you elicit from them those occasions, right? So you get a series of similar events, right? A series. And when you get a series then, right, you get a series of them, they can then see something is going through them all. And you invite them, wait a minute. Would you not agree there are some of those that are more intense than others? There's a certain intensity to them. Could you pick out that which appears to you to be the most intense? And let's compare that with where you're at now. And so now what do? They go through the same thing. They talk about what state that was in. They talk about the situation they were in. They talk about the feeling state. They therefore talk about the thoughts and the images that occurred to them in another time. So therefore, they now have a string, right? They see, therefore, there's something that's happened in their life that they can identify that takes place over a period of time. Cyclical. Hey. But they don't know why it comes and goes. So therefore, this series opens up the cyclical nature of this curious thing that we're calling a block. Say, look here, since you are aware of these states of mind and these problems you've had again and again, cyclical, is it not possible that you should be able now to reflect upon whether or not you can discover an early scene in your early means living with your family, father, mother, brother, sister. This is called This whole process, of course, is called the process of recollection. It brings about reflection. It invites the person to participate in the process. We're just asking questions. There's absolutely no need to give any advice. Advice is absurd. No advice, no suggestions, questions, that's all. And if you got a question, you know you're on a quest. Right? That's what a question is, the activity of being on a quest. You're trying to bring them into the quest. You're trying to elicit their curiosity because they have to be a part of the process of the cure, of the therapy. So now, early scene. If you have an early scene, we're then dealing with a problem in all its remarkable characteristics. That is the subject matter, believe it or not, of Homer's Iliad. Of all the works in literature, if you want to study this philosophical midwifery, the one work that shows a complete mastery of everything I'm saying is Homer's Iliad. Homer's Iliad starts, right? Sing, goddess, of the ruinous wrath that brought upon Achilles innumerous woes and sent down into Hades the souls of many brave and wonderful warriors, all to become the feast of wild dogs and carrion flesh. It's terrible to behold, all for the will of Zeus. That's where it starts. All men are angry. Hey, all men are angry, not anxiety, angry. That's what we're going to see when we get these early scenes. What is it that Homer did? Homer took the worst person in Greek history, the worst person he could dream up, the person who everyone would despise, a total wreck, deceit, dishonest, ripping off the whole culture. And he showed how he could be brought to seeing the roots of his problem by seeing what he learned, when he learned it, under what circumstance he learned it. So now you can see the intelligibility of Achilles. In every detail, it covers everything we're doing. Now I wrote this up and I gave it a paper Greece at a big event, a big conference there. The very funny thing happened there. It was during the Olympics, and the conference was had a banner, and the banner was, "This is the first philosophy in the Olympics." So I came home with that piece of paper, and they had a big stamp on it, and all kinds of people stamped it. And I showed it to my children. They didn't believe it. How could Dad, over 80, get the hell over there in Greece, become an Olympic champion? I showed them the thing. You know. Didn't work. They still thought I made it up in the candy store. But anyhow, back to the liquor. By the way, it's a major article. You can easily get it. All right. It's in the Journal of the American Philosophical Practice Association Journal. My name is there. You can just plug it in on email and you can undoubtedly get a copy. Right. But it goes through the entire Iliad. It sets it up. I show you exactly how to do it. You can now read the magnificent work, including how to study dreams, is also in Homer's Iliad. Remarkable piece of work. The whole Greek culture now, remember, right? From 800 BC all the way to 500 AD, the primary work that everybody learned to write commentaries on and seek analogies to and with is Homer's works. You know, we don't have one copy of anybody's commentary. It's all been destroyed. Tragic, but nonetheless, get my copy, you'll enjoy it. Now, angry. I wonder if I can give you an example so that we can then carry it along. Let us start with talk I had. No. I'll start with the first book. Back in the 50s, I was getting my doctorate, and my father raised me to be a gentleman, but he never left me enough money to be one, so I had to work. So I got a job as a social worker in San Francisco, and they hired a philosopher because no one would want to work with the alcoholics on Skid Row, and therefore they opened the doors to people like myself, so I became a social worker working in Skid Row in San Francisco in the 50s. So. They opened up a center for rehabilitation, and no one wanted to take on the task, so I became the social worker doing psychotherapy. In those days, by the way, anybody could be a psychotherapist. You didn't have to pass a state law and all of those considerations now brought before the public. And so I just sat around and I said, look, I don't know why you guys are alcoholics, but I'd love to hear your stories. So I was working with this one chap. He had a PhD in chemistry. And thank goodness he was periodic, because he'd come after a big drunk and he'd come back all bruised and everything. We'd bring him back, and then he'd go out and do some good work, and then he'd go off on another binge. And so we got to know one another. It was great. You know? And I used to meet him and say, okay, let's chart it out. And we'd go to the blackboard, and we'd put where he went, how he did it. And I said, you know, there are a lot of things that are common in here. He said, yeah, but I don't know why they go on. I said, well, let's just look at it. Yeah. He says, you know, is there something that comes to my mind? He said, you know, maybe it doesn't matter, maybe it isn't significant at all, but when I was a kid, about, you know, 8 or 9 years old, I used to love to play football. And of course, we didn't have any uniforms or anything else, just run out with kids and tackle one another. He said, so my mother would come out to the doorway with me, and she'd say to me in all seriousness, sincerity, and caring, she'd say, son, either come home with your shield or on it. He's off by a few minutes. They were Greeks. And that's the famous slogan of the Spartans in battle. Either come home with your shield victorious, or let them carry you home on your shield. So what did he do? He'd play like hell, and sometimes they had to carry him in, and that's the time he got great consideration from dear old mother. I said, holy Christmas, isn't that interesting? I said, how was she at other times? And he said, well, you know, we had six kids in the house. He said, very little attention given to any one of us. He said, those were really great moments. It's great moments. In what way great moments? He said, well, I mean, she looked at me like I was it. I'm getting the message. All her attention is on me. I feel great. And I go off. He said, yeah. And sometimes I'd come home bruised up, and that's when she'd show great care and attention to me. He said, those are the only times. He said, oh my God, he said, that's what I'm doing. That's what I'm doing. He said, you know what? And then we charted it. Every one of the peaks, when he went off on a drunk, he was reaching some success in chemistry, a major success. That was his battle. And so I said to him, this is at another time. I said, look here. There's something curious about this. Why does it keep repeating? Why can't you have the victory? And he says, you know what? He said, I've been wondering about that since our last talk. He said, you know, if I had a victory, then I wouldn't get all that care and attention coming home on a stretcher. I mean, my helmet. He said, that's when I get really care and people care about me. They come and visit me. He said, that's love. Now, look here. Take a look at this. He took that scene. Right, look here. He took that scene. His mother looked most real, most serious, most centrally involved with him, more than any other time. He could then see her. It showed care. It showed love. She emerged and it focused all her attention on him. Now, in a way in which he never experienced before, hey, he exists. I exist. I am. Plato has one of the greatest lines in the Republic. He says, you know what? He says, you cannot help but imitate those you see who you love when they are most beautiful and good. Hey, this then becomes a model. And now he uses this and he finds himself in scenes similar to this. And he can respond and play out this drama again and again and again. That's a problem. That is a problem. And I said, look here, there's something really great here. Because you took what she said literally, you acted it out. And therefore, the entire time you acted it out in your modern world, in today's drunk, it's like a battle. He said, that's right. It's like a battle. That's what I'm going through. It's like a battle. And I'm looking forward to when I'm wiped out and I'm being brought home on a stretcher. Look. I said, wait a minute. What do you think about what she does? He said, oh, she's wonderful. I said, wait. What would have happened had she showed that much interest similarly to that scene at other times? How important is it that that is rare, unique, sharing some secret. See, she's sharing a secret at that time. That's called, in the history of philosophy and religion, that's called the passing of the Dharma. This is a Dharma successor, Dharma successorship. He now can carry on the family tradition for another generation. He becomes a member of the clan. He's now recognized as one of them. He now has an existence as part of a tradition that reaches back into time, right? All his family know it. They all know how to relate to him and into the future. Problems are ancient. They're carried on because this is a secret way of disclosing to the child what the parent wants them to know about. Now you're getting the secret about life. Now you exist. You're now someone of significance. They're passing on a tradition. What's interesting about that is that with this passing, this is a solution to many things that before were mysterious. Look here. He didn't know why she took this occasion to do it. But now he knows. Now he knows. She'll wait for this occasion because she wants to pass on something terribly significant about what it is to be a man. He grasps that. That's the teaching. That's what it is to be a man. I'll be a man. So we talked about this, see? I said, look here, go back to that question. What would happen had she showed that much interest in a variety of other ways? Suppose she showed that much interest and energy and sharing and caring when you were into mathematics. He said, by the way, you know what? She showed a great deal of care when I was studying mathematics, but only at the exams. I said, oh. He said, look here. I said, what do you think of this? So what do you think about someone who's going to do that? He said, oh, she's wonderful. I said, wait a while. What do you think about someone who waits for this kind of occasion to pass on this teaching, knowing the effect it's going to have on you? Because I don't like that. What do you mean you don't like it? This is what makes me think of my mother now in a different way. I said, what way? Well, I'd rather not go into it. I said, oh, that's okay, it's your business. Yeah, okay. By the way, you don't like that scene? What is it you don't like about it? Well, she should have showed that much care when I was doing things I loved. Oh, well, then what would you say you're learning? Oh, to be like her. Oh. Because you know what? I'm getting angry. Everybody's angry at the injustices that occurred in the passage of this Pathologos, you see. Pathologos is the belief he then inherited. He concluded from this scene. He never knew he concluded it. He never knew that's where he picked up an image of himself. He would never discover it had it not been the fact that our good friend, you know what he was doing? He was going after a goal that was significant. Now, what is this? This is rather interesting. Here's the question. What is it about a problem, about coming to this kind of a conclusion about yourself, what is it about this that produces the anger? Taken advantage of. It's been used to make you a member of the clan. It's put a boundary around what you can do and what you can't do, and you have to live within that. Every pathologos, everything you inherit as a problem, is nothing other than forcing a boundary line around which you are confined and must live out your fate. The images that you then have, you see, the image that you then create from this experience, you don't know until you then test it. Therefore, having a problem allows you to surface this unknown, unsuspected problem. Totally unsuspected. Therefore, it's your gift. But look here, this raises this terribly interesting question. Why are we upset about injustices? What does that mean? Oh, what does that mean? You know what that means? A part of you doesn't like to be treated unjustly. You're treated unjustly in the passage of one of these teachings. You've been victimized. You are a victim. You have a right to be angry and to be mad. But we can't show it because it has no object. We don't know where to put it. And so we burn. We have anxieties over this, that, and the other thing. And then we have to find someone who will say, I'll tell you what to do with those anxieties, you see. All negative emotions just are injurious to the body. It does squirt, right? And all those negative emotions is what we have to control. Therefore, squirt some pills, get some consolation from a therapist or friends or bartenders. They're in that order of importance. okay. Look here. there's something about the self that refuses to allow you to have a false image of yourself. Not yet. Clicker. If you identify with something that is false, right, with something, idea, right, or someone, and what you are, as a consequence, doing is playing out some role that you've been taught, the mind will say, hey, you can't do that. You can't do that. I won't let you. I'll fix it. If you now are going to try to do something meaningful, and you've accepted a false belief about yourself, the mind says you can't pass until you solve it. Now look here, this is what this means. Let these represent person's several problems that they may have. And this means they are confined. They can't go any further. They can't go any further. They're blocked. They're blocked. They're caught right there. Some have greater intensity than other problems. By the way, a person only has a finite number of problems. You know why? Because there are only a certain finite number of people that are their teachers. You can't have a problem if you didn't have a teacher. Your teacher are the people that you love, the people that you respect. You can't learn anything from somebody you can't respect. Not real. Therefore, you only have a finite number of problems. Now, the particular teachers may have more than one problem. And that's the problem with culture. You know, you get to take two extreme cases. If you get a mother who comes from one area of the country and has a set of beliefs appropriate to that and falls in love with someone who's totally different, and a perfect example of that is, can you imagine someone from Brooklyn, right, marrying for someone in L.A.? Could anything be worse? Right? I mean, think of the tragedy that would unfold. Okay, look. Now, a person now is going to go towards something most significant to them, meaningful. This applies to anything, especially meditation. Right? Meditation. Okay? You're after a certain state of mind. As your meditation progresses, the mind is going to offer you all the images that are associated closely with each one of these problems you have. The images, the ideas, the feeling states. Therefore, when you're then meditating and you're now advancing in your psychic progress, you can be blocked. That means you have to deal with this. You have to deal with these, or you can't go any further. Therefore, this philosophical midwifery is a primary tool, especially for people involved in meditation. And one of the titles I picked up in my life is Master of Meditation. Right? Therefore, if meditators, artists, anyone in a creative piece of work, if they're doing something that is personally significant to them, they are going to be, as it were, challenged by these images coming at them with a certain fury. And therefore, they have to learn how to deal with them. Best way of dealing with them is to stop and say, excuse me, that's a very interesting state you're in. Have you been in that state before? Oh, is it possible you have a certain set of feelings left at home? By the way, can you put words on it? Is it possible that you have been in situations where you experienced the similar states of mind? Say, among those, are there some more intense than others? Oh, yeah. Well, why don't you talk about them? Say, is it possible among those similar states you have something early that you've encountered that is even more intense? Oh, yeah. Let's talk about it. Out will come a philosophical midwifery exploration that will release them. They're able then to go on. Another way is you make a deal with yourself. I'll attend to these later. You have to do it seriously. You have to deal with it. Make some promise. You better fulfill it. And then you might be able to go on to the next one. Or, as they say, build up your reiki, or the powers of concentration, and that'll help you overcome some of these. But you know what? When you come back down, they're there. And therefore, people who have reached certain states of enlightenment, let's all congratulate them and offer up, right, a beer in their honor. But you know what? The problems they haven't dealt with, they then have to face, or they're going to act out and live through whether they like it or not. No matter how high, it doesn't make any difference. You still have to go back and you have to deal with those which you ignored, and through the power of concentration, we're able to overcome temporarily. So all you have to do is think about all the people that gained enlightenment experiences in the 20th century, now that we have a whole bunch of people in these things. You can see what happens. They go off this way, they go off that way, do this, that, and the other thing, and they have a whole series of scandals behind them. No, they have things they haven't dealt with. And if you haven't dealt with it, you're going to live it out. Hey, whether you like it or not. Right. And all the praying won't help. Yeah. Well. So look here. Now we're back. What do you do through this? You now need the next step, major step, without which everything we've been doing is ineffective. You have to go back. Face that same challenge where you were blocked before and test it out. Have to go back, otherwise you're sneaking out of this and escaping. But assuming it's something meaningful and significant to you and you decide to go on, you can then see whether such talks are effective. If they're effective, you're able to go on. You might then bump into the next problem and the next problem. Or you're out of them. But what's interesting about the mind is there are some problems that are so subtle, incredibly subtle, that you then finally have to face. Now, Socrates is one of the great examples. He says, you know what? He says, I have a daemon. It whispers. No. Never says what to do. No. We all have that. We don't pay attention to it. He cultivated it, see. That means, therefore, there are things he could avoid. Myself, I had a problem with hearing. And I went to this hearing aid, and I said, do you have one of these hearing, modern digital hearing aids? Because I don't listen to my conscience. And I think I'm deaf. And much to my surprise, they said with all the technology, they didn't have one like it. So if any of you are into, you know, engineering, that kind of stuff, it's a new business, and you'll have a great breakthrough. I have a good name for it, too. But I'll tell you later. It's not the way. Look, what do you got to do? You got to go back to the scene once again. And you have to see your way through it. Second, right? And of course, this may not be possible in some cases. But no one, no teacher of yours who ever passed on the problem knew what they were doing. Watch. Big important thing. they know clearly that they're doing what they do. Right? That they know. What is it they know? They know that they're doing what they're doing. You know what? They don't know why they do what they do, or what they did. They don't know why. And therefore, they don't know what it is they do, or what they are. Therefore, if it's at all possible, it's important to have coffee with your teachers after you get through and say, look, Mom and Pop, this is what I picked up from you. It's important that I share with you. You know why? Because they're human beings and they deserve respect because of all the great things they did to you for your whole life, all the sacrifices, it's worthwhile. Because they introduced these stink bombs in your soul, it doesn't mean they aren't any good. It means they passed it on what they in turn received. And they need, if you can possibly sit down with them, to share your victory so they can see. That's dangerous. Several people might be upset. Yeah. Yeah. Like my father. I won't tell you that story. Okay. Look here. This is becoming human. Everybody has to be respected. Any person you don't respect, it's your problem. You have to respect you have a problem. You have to respect the fact that the person who gave you the problem deserves respect. They didn't know, hey, why they were doing it. You know what you're doing then? You're sharing rationality. You know what this shows? This shows that mankind is rational. We are rational. We're all struggling to achieve what we want. But what we want is always something that we call that is good. So what is this stuff we're doing that I'm now encouraging you to play with and take a look at? You have to have the problems you have, right? Because you've been taught how to deal with life in a certain way that has its built-in limitations. So by studying, right, the necessary, right, problems are necessary. Because what you've been taught, it's necessary that you're going to face blocks. By studying the necessary, and understanding the dynamics of it, you realize we are living in not just a rational universe, but we are part of an intelligible universe. Once you get to that level, you know what this level is? It means, therefore, that mind is divine. And therefore, as we seek our highest goal, it's not our highest goal, it's what we think is most good. Everyone is seeking their good. Therefore, you have to see the role of the necessary as a cause connected with the divine. Therefore, I have a quote. I want to see whether I can now open up to you and share with you. Give you something to reflect on. I think it's a great one. Ah, here we are. These causes, there are two causes, the necessary and the divine. It's in all generated beings. Realizing that the necessary is for the sake of the divine. Because what is necessary? It's necessary we have the problems that we have because we believe teachers who were appeared to be caring, loving, and knowing, and we accepted their teaching and act on it. Therefore, we have to have the problems we have. They're necessary for growth. Right. So you know what? We are mindful that without the necessary, without looking at problems, without understanding them, it's impossible to discover by themselves, the problems alone, the divine, which are the objects of which we seek and strive. That's Plato. That's Proclus. That's Plotinus. Now, if we can take this and show you that everything I've said can be used to understand dreams, nothing new, then we'll go the next step. I'll show you how to take this work and understand dreams and, most essential, daydreams. want to understand people, you want to help people, they're, you know, they have to trust you, right? They have to prove that you're worthwhile, they have to prove that you're careful with their daydreams. If so, they can see the relationship between daydreams, dreams, and their problems. You know what you'll find? We are all part of an intelligible universe. We're all good, screwed up, but we can unscrew the screw. Right? See you next time. Well, you know, guys, there's coffee, and we can sit around and talk for those of you who would like to continue. I've been known to sit around and talk for many hours myself. Join us. Unless you have an interest in popping a question for everyone. So I'll sit around and have coffee. Join me. Thank you for coming. Appreciate your attendance. Thank you.